Recording for this meeting has begun.
Greetings, everyone. Good day, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are in the world. Thank you for joining us. On behalf of Feed the Future and the USAID Bureau for Resilience and Food Security, I welcome you to our webinar, Socioeconomic Impacts of COVID-19 in Four African Countries. I am your host and friendly neighborhood senior knowledge management advisor, Zachary Bakke, with the Bureau for Resilience and Food Security. I will facilitate today's webinar, so you will hear my voice periodically, especially during our question and answer period. Before we dive into the content, let us take a moment to go over a few items to orient you to the webinar. First, please do use the chat box to introduce yourself, ask questions, and share resources. It's a great way to network and get to know folks and establish community. We will collect your questions from the chat box throughout the webinar. We will have our Q&A after the presenters have spoken. To enlarge your screen, you can click on the arrows in the upper right of your screen. This will make the presentation larger. You can click on the arrows again to shrink it back to normal. Also understand that we are, as you note, recording this webinar. The webinar recording, copies of the slide decks, transcripts, and the collection of the questions will all be made available on AgriLinks. We will also email that to all participants of the event. Thank you for your attention. Now onwards to our presentations and discussion for today's webinar, Socioeconomic Impacts of COVID-19 in Four African Countries. Let me introduce to you Chris Hilbrunner. Chris is the Analytics and Learning Division Chief in the Office of Policy and Analysis in USAID's Bureau for Resilience and Food Security. Prior to joining USAID, Chris served as the Deputy Chief of Party for Analysis for the Famine Early Warning System Network, or FuseNet. Chris will introduce the session and the speakers. I hand it over to you, Chris. I'd have to
Can you not hear me, Zachary? I am unmuted. You can't hear me? Okay.
If you want to introduce the speakers.
Great, sorry about that. So this morning I have the pleasure to introduce a panel discussion on the socioeconomic impacts of COVID-19 in four African countries. And there are many interesting aspects to this research that I think the presenters are going to talk about over the course of their presentation. But I'd like to start by just emphasizing at the outset one particularly important aspect of this work that I think really sets it apart from much of the other COVID-related survey work that has been implemented to date. And this is the linkage between the phone surveys that are going to be talked about here and previously implemented living standards measurement surveys. By leveraging the existing LSMS sample and existing LSMS data, the data collected by these phone surveys have benefited in two really key ways. First, the estimates that the presenters discuss are likely to be less biased and more representative than phone surveys that are not connected to a previously identified and surveyed sample. And second, the connection to pre-COVID data allows us to contextualize the phone survey results that are collected. Overall, this higher quality data and the ability to connect it to larger, more comprehensive information on survey households opens up a whole range of analytical possibilities that I think are really exciting. So with that, let me turn to our two presenters. First, we have Taleb Kilic. He's a senior economist at the World Bank Development Data Group, a member of the Living Standards Measurement Study Team, a core member of the World Development Report 2021 on Data for Better Lives, and the focal point for the COVID-19 phone surveys that are supported by the World Bank LSMS team. His research focuses on poverty, agriculture, and gender in low and middle-income countries, as well as survey methodology to improve the quality, timeliness, and policy relevance of household and farm surveys. Our second presenter is Anna Josephson. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Agricultural and Resource Economics at the University of Arizona. Her core research focuses on individuals in and households around the world on issues of risk, development, food security, and agriculture. In her work, Dr. Josephson explores the relationships between individuals and their risky environments, and how households and small firms make decisions to survive under challenging conditions. So with that brief introduction, let me hand things over to Professor Josephson to kick us off.
Thank you so much. Is everybody able to hear me okay? I'm going to assume yes, unless I see otherwise. Thank you for having us here today to talk a little bit about this work. This is joint work with Taleb, who will talk after I do for a little bit, as well as Jeff McClure, who is another professor at the University of Arizona. I also want to highlight some research assistants that we've had on this project, including Josh Brubaker, who is at the World Bank, and Anne Furbush, who's a research associate here at the University of Arizona. So we're grateful for their ongoing support with this. So I think we all know why we're here. COVID-19 has had an enormous impact on human health. I looked yesterday at the WHO, and there are 55 million confirmed cases and over 1 million deaths. And this leads to there will be just enormous, profound economic impacts on the global economy. Estimates from the World Bank indicate that the global economy will shrink by 8%. And while to date, most of this economic burden has been felt in the Americas and in Europe, the pandemic isn't behind us. We're seeing a resurgence now. And low and middle income countries are going to face enormous challenges in the coming months. And these are likely to be exacerbated by limited health systems. So this really motivates what we are doing with this work. The research on the health impacts in low and middle income countries is rapidly emerging. There's a lot of great work on disease transmission and how people are managing the epidemic itself. But the limits have been in understanding and determining how the economic impacts are being felt by households and by countries. And there is an emerging body of literature and some evidence that is coming out now, but much of it is based on macroeconomic models, simulations, or forecasts. And so all of this to say, there isn't a whole lot of survey data that's telling us what's happening on the ground right now. And so this is really important. We need to know how people's lives are really being impacted in this moment if we're going to enable governments and policymakers to understand the circumstances that are really being faced by the people in their countries. Our goal with this work is to provide near real-time quantitative evidence on household responses to and the socioeconomic impacts of COVID-19 in sub-Saharan Africa. And we do this by combining data from two different sources. And Chris gave a really great introduction to how we're doing this, and it's that we have access to the World Bank Living Standard Measurement Study surveys, integrated surveys on agriculture, which are a baseline of surveys that have been collected for many years. And we combine that with interviewing these same households in high-frequency phone surveys. And I'll talk more about the specifics of those surveys in just a minute. Today, we'll be presenting data from 4 countries, Ethiopia, Malawi, Nigeria, and Uganda. And so we'll start to provide some of that quantitative evidence for those 4 countries. Chris gave the perfect introduction because he previewed a lot of what I was planning to say on this slide. One of the really unique and exciting parts about the data that we're using is that it builds off of an existing survey. And so the Living Standards Measurements Study has been collected for many years. TALIP is, I'm sure, able to answer all the particulars of questions that folks might have about that. But by using this existing sample, we're going back and interviewing those people who we've already spoken with previously. And so the COVID surveys in particular are monthly phone surveys that are being conducted in Burkina Faso, Ethiopia, Malawi, Mali, Nigeria, and Uganda. Right now, we're using Ethiopia, Malawi, Nigeria, and Uganda, though we are beginning to integrate the information from Burkina Faso and Malawi. These households will be interviewed every month for 12 months, and they're building off a nationally representative sample of households that was interviewed in the most recent round of the LSMS. So we've been able, these households have been spoken to recently in this broader survey, and now we're going back again and following up with them every month with this COVID specific module. The ability to use the pre-COVID LSMS data is really important, not just from an analytical standpoint of telling us where people were before, but because it also allows us to address some potential bias that comes up if you're not able to have this baseline sample. And so from this original baseline data, we can calculate sampling weights. And these sampling weights help us to counteract selection bias. And the selection bias might come from 2 potential sources. The first source is that if you don't have a phone, then we can't follow up with you for the phone surveys. And people who don't have phones may be systematically different than people who do have phones. And so by weighting our data, we're able to adjust for this potential bias. Additionally, a set of households are targeted in each call to be interviewed, and it may be the case that they're not reachable. This is usually due to phones being turned off or phone numbers not working, rather than the refusal to be interviewed. But in either case, the conclusion is similar. These households may be systematically different, and so we want to be able to adjust for and correct for this bias. So that is really one of the strengths of this work, is being able to integrate these 2 surveys together and to correct for these sources of bias within the analysis. Data and documentation for both the LSMS as well as for the LSMS-supported phone surveys are available through the worldbank.org LSMS COVID-19. So you can check them all out there if you're interested. So I will now dive into results, our initial findings here. I'm going to talk generally about what we've seen and what we've learned in terms of knowledge and some behavioral conclusions, and then I'll pass it over to Talib, who will talk a bit more about what we've learned in terms of food security and education, those sorts of things. So where we're starting is the knowledge that people have of different activities. And so this first slide is looking at individuals' reported knowledge of government actions to curb the spread of COVID-19. And so the respondent in the household is asked about 6 different activities and whether or not they know if the government has undertaken these to stop the spread. And so this includes advice to stay home, restricted travel, closing schools, curfew and lockdown, closed businesses, and stop social gatherings. And what we see in this slide is supported in the next few slides that I'll show. And it suggests that the government actions are important and significant for influencing individuals' knowledge. In particular, you can see that in Uganda and Nigeria and Ethiopia, there are very high levels of knowledge, in particular about stopping social gatherings, and in Uganda and Nigeria, also about advice to stay home and restricted travel. In these three countries, there were lockdowns instituted in March and April, and so the government response to the pandemic was strong. In Malawi, although there were initial attempts to institute lockdowns, ultimately the Supreme Court ruled that those were unconstitutional, and so there was no formal lockdown. There is, though, an exception to that, where you can see there's a quite high knowledge of school closure, and that's because in Malawi, schools were closed. And so you can see that in Malawi, where the response was significantly different than in Ethiopia, Nigeria, and Uganda, people are informed in a different way. And so the next thing that we're able to look at is, what do people know about preventing exposure or reducing their exposure to COVID-19? And so we ask, again, about six specific activities: hand washing with soap, avoiding physical contact, using a mask and or gloves, staying at home, avoiding crowds, and being socially distanced from others. And here you can see, again, that the knowledge of these activities in Malawi is different, significantly different, than in Ethiopia, Nigeria, or in Uganda. In Uganda, there is almost universal knowledge of all six of these activities. And in Nigeria, knowledge is really, really very high. In Ethiopia, also very high, almost 100% of people knowing, ooh, the slides just slid a little bit, 100% of people knowing about the first two activities there, avoiding physical contact and hand washing with soap. When you turn and look at Malawi, using a mask and gloves, staying at home, avoiding crowds, those are significantly lower. And so this isn't a causal relationship between the government, the actions taken by the government, and this sort of knowledge, but it does suggest some sort of trend and correlation between these two relationships. We then, building off of this, so you know about these different activities, which ones have you begun to implement in your life? And so we see a lot of people reporting changes in their behavior to reduce COVID-19 exposure. And this is encouraging because we do see it in every country, even in Malawi. And while the numbers are, while the percentages are slower or shorter in Malawi, there is still a significant increase reported. And so here we're looking at increased hand washing, avoiding physical contact, and avoiding crowds. And again, in Uganda and Nigeria and Ethiopia, you're seeing almost universal practice of these activities. I will add a little caveat to this. When we start to look at future rounds, at more recent rounds of these behaviors, we are seeing a sort of tapering off of some of them. And I think that reflects what many of us might be feeling of a sort of pandemic fatigue and an exhaustion. So it's a very real fatigue that we're seeing all over the world, and will be interesting and important to see if those trends do bear out. So we haven't cleaned up all the data from that at this point. Misconceptions were, I think, a really interesting question that we looked at in Malawi and in Uganda. And so a number of questions were asked about common misconceptions about the disease. And so this includes Africans are immune to coronavirus, coronavirus does not affect children, coronavirus cannot survive warm weather, and coronavirus is just the common flu. And so we see again that people in Malawi are responding in a statistically significant way and believing more of these misconceptions than people who are responding in Uganda. The one exception to that is that coronavirus cannot survive warm weather. That has a very similar response in both of these countries. All right, I will present two more slides and then I'm going to hand it over to Talip to talk about food security. These two slides are talking about our income loss and I think set the stage for some of the socioeconomic consequences that we're seeing in these four countries. So we find that about 258 million people, which is 77% of the population across these four countries, are living in households that have lost income due to the pandemic. So this figure separates urban from rural households in all four countries and looks at four types of income specifically and then an aggregated all other types of income. So this includes farm income, business income, wage income, and remittance income. And those remittance incomes are both from domestic and abroad. And to respond to this question, you needed to be earning this sort of income already. So you'll see that you might not anticipate the parity in farm income that you see between the urban and rural areas. But if you're responding to this question as an urban farmer, then you were already participating in those activities. But you do see massive losses, especially to business income, remittance income, across all four countries. There have been massive losses in income due to the pandemic. This question, when we look at it over time, so here we have two countries, Ethiopia and Nigeria, and three waves of data, May, June, and July. And the way the question is phrased, in that first May question, it is asking about pre-pandemic levels, And so the question is saying, are you making more, less, or about the same income as before? And in May, that before refers to the pre-pandemic. In June and July, it is referring to the previous month. So in June, they're asking relative to May, and in July, they're asking relative to June. And so you see that in this first May round, the majority of people in both of these countries are reporting that they are making less than before. In June and July, you are seeing slightly more people reporting that they are making more income than before, or perhaps the same as before. Though bear in mind, if they're reporting making the same as before, that's just that they're suffering similar losses as they were in the first month of the pandemic. But we do see, in Nigeria in particular, a slight rebound, potentially, in this sort of income and in these sorts of earnings. So I will now turn it over to Talip, who will talk about some of our findings about food security and those sorts of things. So Talip, take it away.
Okay, Anna, thank you so much, and thanks again for having us. So I'm just gonna give you an overview of the rest of the findings in our working paper, which I don't know if it was mentioned earlier in the discussion, but is also available through the World Bank Policy Research Working Paper Series, and I think it was part of the seminar invite as well. So, for more details, in case we cannot get to answering all of your questions in this limited time, please check out our paper as well and feel free to reach out to us. So I'm going to talk a bit about food insecurity. We'll be diving into issues related to concerns that are reported regarding household finances and health. And then we'll be talking about access to staple foods, medicine, soap, and then we'll end with a few findings on education. So on food security, in our phone surveys we've included the food insecurity experience scale module, which is an 8-question scale that is for the related SDG indicator on food insecurity, which allows us to compute these comparable estimates of moderate or severe, or simply severe food insecurity across our country. So on the basis of those findings, so these are some cross-sectional results based on the most recent round of phone survey data available from the Ethiopia, Nigeria, Malawi, and Uganda. We see that moderate or severe food insecurity affects 62% of the adult population across these four countries, which amounts to 102 million adults. The severe food insecurity alone affects about 38 million adults, or 23% of the adult population. We do see differences across pre-COVID-19 household consumption quintiles. So just a note on this, you know, one of the advantages of using LSMS surveys as sampling frames from the phone survey is that we can bring forward this pre-existing information about household consumption status to look at heterogeneity across different levels of consumption. So we see that poorer households in lower quintiles consistently across the countries that we're looking at suffer significantly greater prevalence of food insecurity, both in terms of moderate or severe or severe food insecurity, which is depicted on the right panel. There are, however, significant cross-country heterogeneity in the prevalence of, in the overall prevalence of food insecurity, and these country-level estimates are statistically significantly different from one another for both indicators. We see that the prevalence of moderate or severe food insecurity is highest in Nigeria. That's about affecting 76% of the adults, or 63 million. That's followed by Malawi at 68%, Ethiopia at 47%, and Uganda at 33%. Looking at some of these estimates by gender of the head of household, we see that moderate or severe food insecurity is significantly more common in female-headed households, and we don't pick up significant differences in severe food insecurity estimates across male versus female-headed households. Although we're not showing, we also see that food insecurity is actually is decreasing over time at an equal rate for both. Types of households. In our surveys, the respondents were also asked to report their concerns regarding COVID-19 being a threat to their household finances, or regarding whether they feel that themselves or a family member may fall ill with COVID-19. First of all, a general observation, which is not directly shown in this graph, is that the level of concern in these dimensions are high across four countries and weigh heavily on individuals. We see from our data that estimated 78% of the adults, or you know, just over 250 million people, are concerned that either themselves or a family member may fall ill with COVID-19. And similarly, 88% of the adults are concerned about COVID-19 threat to their household finances, which translates to nearly 300 million people. One of the things we could do is to look at associations between food insecurity and the reported concerns. We see that the higher prevalence of food insecurity, both in terms of moderate or severe food insecurity, is associated with concerns about household health and financial well-being, especially in Malawi. There is, however, substantial degree of heterogeneity in the degree of concern over health and finances based either on food insecurity, initial wealth, or gender of the head of household. So we're not showing that here, but we couldn't necessarily discern clear patterns in terms of specific indicators that we were able to bring into this analysis to understand the heterogeneity in the degree of concern. There's some story we tried to tell here by bringing in information about the variation in the prevalence of food insecurity across consumption quintiles by whether a financial or a health-related concern was registered by the respondent. But those comparisons do not reveal a clear pattern. This is shown for moderate or severe food insecurity here. The next slide is on severe food insecurity, but the results are pretty much the same. We don't really see a clear pattern across the consumption quintiles and by whether the concern was reported. And you know, that just I think shows us that, you know, it does weigh heavily on individuals in many contexts across the board. In Nigeria specifically, you know, one of the things that we are able to do on food insecurity is bring in information from pre-COVID-19 LSMS survey to compare to the information that we collected through the phone surveys. Nigeria is the only country where we are able to do this, where the FIES module was included in the same survey that served as the sampling frame for the phone survey. Interestingly, looking at the pre-COVID-19 data that was collected 2 years prior to the implementation of the phone survey round, so these are comparisons from June of 2018, July of 2018 to June 2020, when the phone survey round was implemented, we see a significant uptake in both measures of food insecurity over time. So that's about 26 percentage points for moderate or severe food insecurity, and about 20 percentage points for severe food insecurity alone. We don't show the pattern specifically for urban and rural areas, but the trends are fairly similar. So. So in Nigeria, there has been an uptake in food insecurity in the post-pandemic period, and this basically calls for deepening the analysis in this particular direction in this particular context, where we also have pre-shock information on food insecurity. Next. I'm going to talk a bit about access to the basic necessities and education. We asked in our surveys questions about unmet needs regarding medicine, staple foods, which differed by country, and soap. There were also questions earlier on, though. So asked in different times in different countries about drinking water and water for hand washing. Those initial results did not raise red flags in terms of high levels of unmet needs. But we have since incorporated those questions in the more recent rounds of the phone surveys in these countries, and we'll be looking into that over the next few weeks to see if the unmet needs are exhibiting differences over time. So what we can do with that data is that conditional on households having sought to purchase any of these goods in the last 7 days prior to the interview, we can estimate the percentage that was unable to buy what they need. So probably the most positive outlook here is regarding soap, where only 12% is 12% of the households that tried to buy soap were unable to do so. Regarding staple foods, the comparable estimate is 24%. Regarding medicine, it's about 20%. We do see in this graph that, you know, the level of unmet need clearly varies by consumption quintile, as to be expected. The households that were in the lowest consumption quintile prior to the pandemic are significantly less likely to be able to access the medicine that they need than the households in the highest consumption quintiles. And similarly, the households that are in the lowest consumption quintile are less likely to have access to the staple food that they need, as well as the soap that they need, than households in other quintiles. Finally, a few slides on education specifically. Prior to the pandemic, we estimated that 96% of the households with school-age children had their kids attending school. So the surveys in turn asked questions about participation in educational activities as early as the first round of data collection. So we see that following the outbreak and the subsequent school closures in our countries, the incidence of school-age children, school-age household members that are engaging in any learning activity, fell from 96% to 48%. And though we're not showing explicitly in this particular graph, the incidence of student-teacher contact also fell to 17%, which is maybe to be expected, but the estimate previously unknown. So this, I guess, headline findings amount to 68 million school-age kids across these four countries without any educational engagement in this pandemic period. And as with access to basic necessities, we see that lack of access to education is particularly pronounced among poorer households. So children from households in the top 40% of the pre-COVID-19 consumption distribution are more likely to be engaged in any learning activity after the school closures compared to kids from households in the lower quintiles. So this loss of educational contact, obviously widespread. We're concerned about potential long-term effects. Although we also see that the households are using whatever technology that is at their disposal, radios, televisions, in some cases mobile learning apps, to try and mitigate these educational losses. So the surveys did ask questions about the mode that they use to engage in specific educational activities, and these were these were multi-select questions, so they could have reported different avenues that they were seeking. We see that millions of children in these countries are participating in various types of educational contact, but again, millions remain unable to do so. The estimated share of households with school-age children using these technologies is, in fact, lower than 50%. This may have short-term consequences for adults that are trying to return to work, as well as kids' long-term educational outcomes. There is some good news, though. In countries where we have this information collected over time, in this case, we're using earlier rounds of information, we have more recent data available, but in the context of the information that was collected in May through July period, and at least Ethiopia and Nigeria, we see that the use of several of these technologies is increasing over time, and we also know that even in terms of the student teacher contact in Ethiopia, Malawi, and Nigeria, we see an upward trend over time. And lastly, we do still see linkages between economic outcomes and educational attainment. In the context of food insecurity, we see that the incidence of moderate or severe food insecurity is significantly higher in households where school-age children are not engaged in learning activities. That is true across the board, although we don't find statistically significant differences in the incidence of severe food insecurity specifically by whether households had any school-age children that were engaged in educational activities. So this was a fairly broad overview of the first set of results that are coming through the phone surveys. As Anna took us through, we saw that the initial government action, you know, may influence knowledge and behavior of individuals insofar as reducing COVID-19 transmission. There are large shares of households that are reporting income losses since March, since the start of the pandemic, and the ensuing government restrictions in many of our countries, and significant shares of households that are still struggling with moderate and severe food insecurity, though there's slight improvements over time that we have not shown today, but hopefully over the next few weeks as we update the analysis. We have seen reported difficulties in the ability to purchase basic necessities and heterogeneity across pre-COVID-19 consumption distribution, where poorer households, particularly the poorest households, are less likely to access what they need. In terms of impacts on the educational sector, I think they have been stark, particularly vis-a-vis the pre-COVID-19 levels of educational engagement. You know, few students have been able to engage in learning activities since school closures. There is some improvements over time that we will keep monitoring. In fact, in the latest round of the phone surveys that were implemented, we've actually expanded the information collection to now be at the level of the child. So I think a deeper analysis could be pursued. I think we've also seen that there's quite a bit of cross-country heterogeneity in, you know, I think there are several findings that held to, you know, that were held true across our countries, but also quite a bit of heterogeneity across countries. I think the comparability of the survey instruments do help at least ruling out that portion of the story that may otherwise be compounded. So I think the heterogeneity across the countries do raise several research questions that could then be delved into a bit deeper in subsequent analysis. And I think there is continued need to monitor these household level impacts and responses, just given the extent of the adverse effects, and also some of the negative coping strategies, which we haven't delved into in detail today, but can go into in the discussion that are presented in the paper. The phone surveys, you know, we're now in fact through this analysis beginning to scratch the surface, but we have a pretty good platform set up to be able to ingest the incoming data, to be able to extend this analysis in a comparable way. So the phone surveys are going to be implemented, you know, on a monthly basis in a 12-month period. So that started in May of this year. So until about May / June of 2021, we'll have a steady flow of these monthly data coming out and being made also publicly available. As Anna said in her slides, please check out our website to access these data sources. We hope to extend the analysis in specific dimensions. I also saw several questions come in through the discussion, so maybe I'll stop here and can give a bit more detail on the scope of the data collection as well as the planned analysis in our Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Talib. Thank you, Anna, both for great presentations. Really appreciate the rich discussion that's been going on in the chat box. And I want to give a special thanks also to Jeffrey Mischler, who is one of the co-authors on the paper, who's been doing an outstanding job of answering questions in the chat box, as well as Leslie Perlman, who's with us in RFS, the Bureau for Resilience and Food Security, who's also been jumping in and answering questions in the chat box. So thanks, everyone, for providing this discussion. And now we'll kind of go to a Q&A for, to answer some of those questions that haven't been touched upon in the chat box. So with that, would go to a question from Vicky Marone. I know that this was partially answered in the chat box, but wanting to get some expansion on it. How do you adjust for sampling for the many families who do not have phones? If you could explain a bit more.
All right, Talib, to answer that, I think he can weigh in on the particulars of the LSMS a bit better.
Okay, sounds good. Vicky, thanks. Yeah, thanks a lot for the question. So as Anna tried to explain in her slides, the advantage that we have is the background information on both the households that do not have phones, as well as the households that we may attempt contacting in the phone surveys that we may not be able to reach. So in the cases of all of the countries that you've seen today, our aim was to contact all households with telephone numbers that had been previously interviewed in an LSMS IFA supported survey. The exception was Nigeria, because the LSMS IFA survey was fairly large, and the mobile penetration is also large. So we had more households than we needed, so we subsampled, and then we made phone calls to that subsample. So that background information is key to be able to understand how different these households are from those that do not have phones, and how different households are when we try and make calls but could not reach them. So we calibrate our sampling weights, the baseline sampling weights that we have, by estimation of these response regressions that allow us to compute probabilities of response, and those propensity scores we use to reweight our sample. As such, it counteract against that selection bias. So that regression is pretty key for that bias adjustment, and that basically includes a slew of factors that basically explains why households don't have phones to begin with, and also why we may not get those households. So we have some material and some discussion in the supplementary materials of our paper, so I encourage you to check that out, and if you have any other questions, just feel free to reach out.
Thank you, Talib. We have another question from Phil Steffen. Would you have attempted the COVID-19 telephone surveys in the absence of this background information from the LSMS sample frame? Would one even attempt these surveys on a cold call basis?
Yeah, so there are survey efforts where sampling frames do not exist for phone surveys, and they're using random digit dialing. The main problem associated with those surveys is that we don't necessarily know the extent of the bias, because we're only reaching the population that we can reach on the mobile phones, and we don't have any background information on other segments of the population. So that is the big drawback associated with those efforts, that we don't always know the extent to which it impacts analysis. But yes, there are efforts also supported by the World Bank that have used random digit dialing.
Excellent. Another question from Aftab Khan is, any ideas why schools, any idea why school-going children had lesser food insecurity because of school lunch, but weren't the schools closed?
Yeah, this is an interesting finding. I think that it is probably reflecting a vulnerability in these households more broadly, that the children who were immediately unable to attend school are in households that are also food insecure. And so they're suffering on these two fronts, not just being taken out of school, but also dealing with food insecurity within their household. I don't think that at this point we have the information to weigh in on whether there were feeding programs or anything like that that would have influenced those findings.
Just a quick note. I mean, in the baseline surveys, we can take a look. There is some information about participation in social safety nets, and I think school feeding programs is one of them. So that information may be useful to bring into our analysis to understand a bit more about the role that, say, lack of school feeding, how lack of participation in school feeding programs because of school closures may have mediated some of these results we're seeing on food insecurity, higher food insecurity prevalence in households without kids that are engaged in educational activities.
Thank you. Another question, which I think has appeared a couple of times in the chat, is asking about how much did individuals in rural areas were affected with insecurity versus those in urban areas?
Yeah, so we do have information that disaggregates everything by urban and rural sectors. And I've actually been looking on my computer right now to figure out, because I know we've made this graph before, differentiating food insecurity in particular across these two sectors. But unfortunately, it's not at the front of my fingertips right now. I don't know if Talib or Jeff, if you remember off the top of your head, whether the two were statistically different from one another. So I do know that's something that we've looked at, and that we look at in terms of a lot of these different parameters that we consider to see if they are actually different than one another.
I think we've done that earlier on in the process, but did not come across significant differences. So I think that's one of the reasons why we did not report that here, but I think we did look at that earlier on, because there was a concern around, actually, well, maybe that lack of finding is interesting to report in and of itself, because the earlier concerns were about urban areas in particular, and the food insecurity that may be brought on by the economic impacts that were projected to be felt a bit more in the urban areas. But I don't think we picked that up in the data.
Yeah, and so Jeff just confirmed in the chat what we were both saying as well, that we didn't see those statistically significant differences. And so we don't report it in the paper or in this presentation, but perhaps it would behoove us to do so, as I think the expectation is that they would be different.
Thank you. We just got a question from Willie Malimbi. African governments haven't taken the lockdown at the same time. Have you found any effect of those lockdown measures?
So we do see I suppose one thing to look at would be to see how this changes over time based on how government policies changed. But Ethiopia, Nigeria, and Uganda all did lock down at very similar times. So we haven't been able to differentiate between the exact timing of the implementation of that policy. In Malawi, we can see some of those differences, as the lockdown there was abbreviated and significantly different than in these other countries. I think it will be interesting, as we continue to get these data over the next 12 months, to see how the different policies implemented by the government, and as well as much as possible, I see a lot of chat about this, about the difference between the stated policy and the lived policy, if we can integrate those to understand how that might be influencing people's behavior and knowledge differently.
Thank you. And as kind of a broader question, perhaps, Judith Appleton has asked, what surprised you about your data and the findings?
Oh, I really like that question. I guess surprised. I've been surprised at the number of children who have lost access to schooling. I guess I shouldn't be surprised, but I have found those numbers to be particularly striking, that we've, as a global community, so much progress has been made towards that sustainable development goal of universal primary education, and seeing these losses of children enrolled in school and going to school and interacting with a teacher has been really striking and sobering to me. I think Talp and Jeff may also have their own thoughts.
Yeah, so one of the, I guess, one of the interesting aspects of this analysis, I'm not sure if it's surprised or maybe sobering, as Anna put it, was about both the behavioral impacts and also whatever questions we have included on subjective well-being. So in fact, on subjective well-being, you know, the level of the concerns that were registered by individuals, you know, across the consumption distribution was very stark. In fact, that lack of heterogeneity we're finding in reported levels of concern is, I think, telling of how much these concerns have potential mental burden on our individuals, on the individuals that we interview. Also, on subjective well-being, you know, one area that we are interested internally in expanding data collection is on mental health. And I think these are, you know, as the lockdown or the restriction fatigue sets in, obviously we see some changes in behaviors being relaxed, but also on the mental health side, we don't necessarily have an idea about how certain non-communicable health outcomes are changing over time. So I think that's going to be one area, kind of brought on by some of the findings on registered concerns that we will be delving into.
Thank you. And I noted that Jeffrey Mishler had also provided some thoughts in the chat box as well. I would follow up that question in terms of recommendations that you might have. We've had that from a couple of folks. Jennifer Lishner, you know, considering the number of ongoing impact evaluations with baselines or endline surveys happening this year and next year, do you have any recommendations that should be considered in light of the LSMS findings?
Oh, I'm going to sort of not answer your question, but to also sort of answer your question, and then I can hand it over to Tal for other recommendations. One thing, and someone else raised this in the chat, I believe, is some of this data is we're sort of functioning on a little bit of a delay just by the difficulty of cleaning the data and then making them available and then actually reporting out the results. And so I think a lesson here is that this we can get these up-to-date information, though it takes time to actually put them together and disseminate them. And so I've been thinking about what we might be able to learn from this slight lag or how we can do this more quickly. I imagine, though, that your question was more about the specifics of what you would tell someone to do based on what we've found so far. Talib, do you want to chime in?
Yeah. So on impact evaluations, in fact, we had an internal meeting just between us and the IFAD Research Impact Assessment Division just last week, and they're grappling with basically how to get organized for impact evaluations for their internal reporting, and they have various countries in different stages of implementation. As you've said, some are trying to roll out a baseline, others are trying to follow up on baselines or midline surveys. So I think, there are a number of things that one may worry about in the application of phone surveys in the context of impact evaluations. I think, because you are, particularly in contexts where you have actually implemented this baseline survey that you're following up on, specific survey mode effects that may impact your results. You may also worry about this differential response, or the fact that you may not be able to reach all of your treatment and control groups through the phone. Some of that bias, in phone ownership, or the extent to which you reach specific population groups, may be different in treatment and control groups. So I think there's a number of complexities in thinking about phone surveys for impact evaluation, which, I think should be a last resort. But having said that, surveys are beginning to go back to the field for face-to-face data collection. The costs are significantly higher. So, for field work data collection, because of this additional COVID-19 safety protocols that you now have to put in place, mainly related to, say, the vehicles you hire for your mobile teams, different PPE you need to procure for your survey staff and maybe also for your respondents, the costs are going to be higher, and some of the strict protocols also have to be followed. Whose enforcement is not always very straightforward. So I think we're going to be grappling with a number of different issues here in face-to-face data collection. But in general, I would say phone surveys should be a last resort for these impact evaluations because of the various complexities that may then mediate the robustness of your findings. So.
Thank you both. So noting there's tons of questions, we appreciate you typing in your questions and having the conversation in the chat box. This is very rich, and again, this will be provided as a resource after the event, so you can go back through and take a look at what people were asking and what people were sharing in terms of resources. As another question from participant Richard Rapier, how will the results from the water sanitation and hand washing be reported out?
So I think Talib can...
Thank you for the question.
Oh, go ahead, Talib.
Sorry, Anna. I didn't mean to jump in. But I refer to water. That's why the question maybe came. So we are working on an update to this paper. And I think as part of that, we hope to converge on that by early December. For a book that will be then published in January. So I think as part of that book chapter, we'll have more up to date findings on issues related to access to drinking water and access to water for hand washing. Basically, based on the more recent rounds of data that we were able to collect. Different than the survey rounds that have informed our analysis today.
Thank you. Another question from William Anderson, who's particularly interested in how your research and research methods relate to drivers of instability and conflict in fragile states and situations in Africa and other regions. There are initiatives in the U.S. to focus more on crisis and conflict prevention in foreign assistance and foreign policy. Your thoughts?
I think this also ties to a question that Leslie Otto just asked about how we can account for the political unrest that's ongoing in Ethiopia right now and how we're going to be able to include that. And this is, I'll just be honest, this is a perspective I hadn't thought about until right now, but that's going to have really significant effects on what we find and what these surveys are reporting. And I guess I'm going to sort of put Talib on the spot a little bit. Do you know if there are efforts to adjust the upcoming round of the COVID surveys?
Okay, so this is these particular developments. Okay, in the case of Ethiopia, but also in Mali, we saw it the military coup in August has first of all real implications for the phone survey implementation. So I will come to the substantive question that was phrased at the beginning, but from a practical standpoint, right now. We faced, I think, two or three delays or pauses in data collection in Ethiopia because of the security situation. So that one we always have to work around because it often has implications for the communication systems. I mean the mobile networks. So in the case of Mali, for instance, because of the military coup, the World Bank suspended all of its projects, including our survey data collection that we were supporting through the NSO, the National Statistical Office in Mali. So, in some way, we are impacted by these events. And I think in specific countries, we do have questions around government effectiveness. In COVID-19, dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic or effectiveness of specific measures that may change over time, also in line with these developments that we may be able to pick up in later surveillance. So that's sort of an open question. I mean, in general, to be able to do robust research on how to tie conflict or fragility with like data on conflict or fragility with microdata elicited from households, we also need some disaggregated data that could be interoperable with our household survey data, often on the basis of geographical linkages. So that information is not, you know, because it's not a hot topic, it's not always there in every country. So here we're looking at, you know, specifically four countries. In the case of Nigeria, or like in the case of, you know, specific countries, for instance, also Uganda, some of the fragility and the conflict tends to be very geographically concentrated, which means that you know, we don't have the sufficient resolution, we don't have sufficient sample points in our survey data that is elicited from areas that are subject to fragility and conflict, just because it's not as covariant, it's not as widespread as to be captured in a national survey. So there's some specific limitations, but in countries such as, for instance, Mali, where we have maybe more widespread fragility and conflict, where we may be able to conduct more interesting analysis, I think some of that research may be more of a possibility. So I think it's a very interesting question. It's also, I think, a kind of a question that may, in specific countries, say something about the limits of these national surveys, you know, phone or face-to-face, to be able to say something about the linkages between fragility and conflict and generally welfare and human development outcomes.
Thank you, Talib. Kind of a follow-up question that we've had from a couple of folks is, how much has the phone call survey and its analysis cost? And I'm sure there are probably implications in terms of, you know, the situations on the ground that you just mentioned as well.
Thank you, Zachary. So I was just trying to look up. I have some specific statistics on this in terms of the unit cost. So if you could just give me, maybe we can take another question and I can look up in the meantime, and then we can circle back before the end of.
Okay. Yep. Sounds fine. Another question, you know, in terms of, you know, as part of AgriLinks, we're all keen about learning, is, you know, from Vicky Marone, is, will this info be discussed with each respective country's Ministry of Health and not just sent as a report? And sort of understanding the level of country involvement in the process.
So unfortunately, this is also...
Thank you. Yeah,
thank you. I was going to say that Talib is better positioned to answer than I am.
Okay. So, no, thanks, Anna. So I was just going to say that, okay, you know, ours is one of the, you know, one of the many, I think, analytical outputs that are being produced on the basis of publicly available data. So first of all, for each country, whenever a survey, specific survey round is implemented, we produce a country-specific report, which is then disseminated at the country level, and is made available alongside the microdata. So in each country, that dissemination entails a virtual dissemination where different set of country partners are invited, and obviously Ministry of Health is among those stakeholders, but also the dissemination in many cases, dissemination efforts do leverage World Bank colleagues, sectoral World Bank colleagues at the country level that have relationships with, say, sectoral ministries that they closely work with. So, for instance, in the case of Uganda, we had a special briefing other than the dissemination event with Ministry of Health. So in every case, when we disseminate, the country team for the World Bank is in the loop. They provide feedback on the pre-public version of the report so that we improve. And not as part of a clearance, because we independently produce these things, but we do incorporate their comments from a technical standpoint. And then so they're made aware of this every set of results from each survey round, and that they also highlight that through their channels and their sectoral colleagues on the government side. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you. A question from Aftab Khan. Africa has 41% mobile phone specific gender gap. How did you avoid a gender bias in the survey?
Yeah, so gender is something that we've looked at pretty extensively to get a sense of how, in particular, female-headed households may be impacted differently than male-headed households. Within the potential bias in phone ownership, we are attentive to that issue, and that is something that by using these survey weights, we are able to adjust for that women may be owning cell phones or have access to cell phones at different rates than their male counterparts. I can also say we've looked at differences in outcomes by gender with respect to income losses, with respect to food insecurity, with respect to just concerns about COVID-19. Are households that are headed by women more worried about losses from different income sources or are becoming ill, as well as coping mechanisms, how households are adjusting and able to cope with these shocks, and that includes like relying on savings, selling your assets, and those sorts of things. And so those are reported in our paper that's available online, but we are seeing statistically significant differences with respect to food insecurity in particular, where female-headed households are experiencing more food insecurity, and coping strategies that are employed by these households also differ by the gender of the household head. Those coping strategies are significantly different by country as well. So there's a lot of kind of cross tabs going on there with how households are responding with respect to gender. We all have a sort of special interest in looking and understanding how different sorts of households have been able to cope with this, so both looking at male and female-headed households, and then I remember seeing some questions about migrant households in the chat as well, so looking at those sorts of households and understanding how, based on the initial circumstances, are some households in a better position to be resilient to this catastrophic shock than other sorts of households.
Thank you, Anna. Another question is from Clara Colina. Is there a difference between how food insecurity is impacting farming versus non-farming households?
I think you're predicting our one of the papers that we're working on right now. We're so agriculture is one of the LSMS is the LSMS ISA, which has an extended agricultural component. So agriculture is near and dear to all of us. And so one of the things that we're looking at is delving into how households that participate more in agriculture relative to other households, how are they coping with this? And so that's something that we're hoping to look at as the next few rounds come out and as agricultural seasons in these different countries progress. But we're hoping to be able to see if you have a greater reliance on agriculture, are you impacted differently than if you have a higher reliance on business income or you have some non-farm enterprise going. And I guess I could speculate wildly on what we would expect to see, but depending on the lockdown policies that people are experiencing, it may be the case that agriculture, as is seen in some other studies, agriculture may be a sort of safe haven that people end up returning to. So that again brings us back to migration, where people will be returning to their home on farm away from other city locations. Yes, that is something we're
I don't know. One thing that I was going to note is that actually in countries where we have information on participation in agricultural activities, we've implemented separate modules specifically on agriculture, though their content is in line with what is happening in the agricultural season at that particular point in time. So there's post-planting modules, there's post-harvest modules, there are modules specifically on livestock. So in agriculture, one interesting thing to highlight is that the extent of participation in smallholder agriculture actually increased over time across countries, and particularly actually for households that are located in urban areas, which I think could be interpreted as a coping strategy in and of itself, because in Africa, obviously, people still trace their roots back to rural areas in a very stark fashion. So these connections to the rural areas are still there, even for the urban households. So urban agriculture is fairly common in Africa. Not only in say backyard gardens in urban areas, but maybe through the connections in their home villages and the farms that they keep there. So this increase in agricultural participation we did pick up. We haven't reported that today, but it is there. We have a separate task force that is explicitly focused also on agriculture, like beyond this research activity that Anna just shared with you. And I'm not sure how best to circulate that information, but maybe I can share it with Zach. There's another webinar I think happening tomorrow on this particular topic that will be delivered by two of our team members. So if you all are interested, that might be another endless series of webinars you can consider. And also, yeah, sorry, in the chat box I did paste in the current unit cost estimates per completed interview for our phone surveys in 2020 US dollar terms.
Excellent. Well, I'd like to thank our speakers, Talib and Anna, for their excellent presentation and the fantastic job of answering questions. I'd also like to extend a big thanks again to their co-author, Jeffrey Mishler, who's been in the chat box and has just been a mad fiend in terms of answering questions and driving the conversation there. And also to Leslie Perlman, my colleague from the Bureau for Resilience and Food Security, who's also been helping out with the questions and answering questions in the chat box. Thank you all for your help and participation in driving this conversation. And thank you, our AgriLinks community and audience, for participating and joining us today. I know there's often quite a selection of webinars that people can join and have a conversation in. I'm glad you took the time today to join ours. We're going to put up some polls, kind of exit polls or evaluation polls, to see how you have enjoyed or found today's presentation. Please take a moment before you exit to fill out the polls, provide us with feedback, answer any questions. You can also download the slide deck from today's webinar on the left in file downloads, or go to the link for the event page. Again, the event was recorded for today. We will send out a email to participants, which will have all of the resources from today's event, so recording of the webinar, transcripts, additional resources that you can then access at your leisure. So again, wherever you are in the world, please stay safe, stay healthy, and we appreciate you continuing to engage with the AgriLinks community. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. Have a great day.